ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. You do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes forth from the mouth of God. Alleluia, alleluia. Here two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in the midst. Whatsoever you ask of me, I will do for you.
Thank you.
shore, and I know there'll be no more tears in heaven.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to worship this morning. We warmly welcome all of our guests who are worshiping with us this morning, and our regular members too as well, and those of you who are worshiping with us online. If you'd like to follow along with the bulletin, you can find that link on our webpage, also our giving portal too as well. And I would encourage everyone to read the announcements for yourselves, which you can find printed in the bulletin. This morning we have a special couple minutes here that are going to come to us from the deacons, and the chair of the deacon board is here with us today, and that's Adele Marcatoli. So Adele, I'm going to invite you to come on up here to the microphone.
Good morning. As most of you know, October is Pastor Clergy Appreciation Month. So with that in mind, the deacons would like to recognize the following people. So as I call your names, would you please come forward so the congregation can see your beautiful faces? Okay, Pastor Lori. Pastor Annie Hines. Reverend Grace Basham. Pulpit Supply Leslie Stone. And our animal chaplains, Daniel Burick and Elise Marcatoli. If you want to stand right there, that'll work. Okay. We're missing Daniel. Okay. That's all right. Pastor Lori, Annie, Grace, Leslie, and our animal chaplains, Daniel and Elise. We're so grateful for each of you and for your sincere love for us. We're also grateful that our church truly feels like a family, including our four-legged furry friends. Each of you have shown that you really care for us, whether it's through hospital visits, one-on-one conversations, prayer meetings, Bible studies, or fellowship events. We thank you for being such a great example of living a life of faith. You all are a blessing to our church, and you make a difference, not only at First Presbyterian, but in the community. So on behalf of the deacons, we want to say thank you for modeling sacrifice and love every week. And now before we present each of you with a small token of our appreciation, I'll close with prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for Pastor Lori, for Annie, for Grace, for Leslie, for Daniel and Elise. Please, God, continue to be with them in their ministries. We ask that the Holy Spirit is their guide each and every day. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, Patty.
Patty will hand out the little
That's so nice. Thank you very much. Thank you, deacons, and thank you, congregation, too. Thank you. Oh, I love this congregation. Oh, thank you. How nice. I like those polka dots. Oh, yeah, take Daniels. He said he was coming. He might have lost track of time there. Well, my brothers and sisters, as we begin our worship this morning, remember that Jesus Christ is here in this time and in this place. It is Jesus Christ who stands at the door of our heart and who knocks. And when we open that door and we invite him in, he has promised to come and be with us and to dwell within us. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I invite you now to open your hearts, open your minds, open your spirits as we begin to worship God. Thank you. Please join with me in prayer. Loving and holy God, we thank you and we praise you for this time of worship, for this day, for the souls that are here, both in body, in spirit, and online. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that we believe overshadows us, that is able to anoint our mind, our lips, our heart, and root us ever more deeply within the reality of life that is you. We thank you for the grace that awaits us in these moments of worship and of praise, of thanksgiving to you. May it be a blessing for you and to you, and a blessing to us. In Christ's name we ask these things, amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, as we begin our service this morning, please stand and join together. How great is our God. You can find that as a bulletin insert. Brothers and sisters, while you're still standing, please turn to someone near to you and maybe a new face and offer them the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May God's peace be with you all. God's peace be with you. You find your way back to your seats. We once again take up our order of worship and we turn our hearts and our minds to our prayer of humility. We confess silently and in community. We confess this audibly, our communal prayer, because it reminds us we are all in need of the forgiveness and the compassion and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as we accept these gifts, we in turn are called to extend them just as readily to one another. So at this time, I invite you to join together in our prayer of humility. Gracious God, you made a covenant with our ancestors. We gather here today as people who have forgotten the promises made so long ago. You offer bread to every living creature, and we often steal that bread from our brothers and sisters in the name of greed. You promise us a new life, but we shrink back in fear, clinging to our death-dealing ways. Heal us, O Lord. We need your healing presence among us, that your righteous and just intentions for all of creation might be fulfilled at last through Jesus Christ. And hear us now as we silently confess our sins. In Christ Jesus, we ask these things. Amen and amen. Friends, the truth is that our loving God knits us more closely together in the fellowship of Christ Jesus each day, so that we might offer ourselves, our lives, our resources, to be the hands of Christ Jesus reaching into the world, to be the instruments of God's peace. Please join together in our baptismal promises. Through the waters of baptism, we have died with Christ and are raised with him. With gratitude and with faith, we will walk the way of Christ. And this is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Please stand. Thank you. Please be seated.
The first reading is from Psalm 22. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. I will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. The second reading is from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Before I offer the scripture this morning, I just want to say again, thank you to the deacons and thank you to my partners in ministry. It is a wonderful, healthy sign in a church, in a congregation, when so many people are active, not only in commission and ordained ministry, but in the congregation as well. And I would say in this congregation, the majority of our people are somehow involved in some form of active service and ministry to the congregation, the community, to God. So I thank you, because I really don't have this call without all of you. And I, again, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And it's apropos that we have this special reading this morning. It does come to us from the lectionary again, which is a fancy liturgical word, a churchy word that simply means before the printed scripture. There were 3 years where the entire scripture was read from the pulpit every single day if people went to worship. And at that time, in the early days, they probably would have gone to Mass every day. And we still use that in the mainline traditions, this lectionary, the 3 years. And right now we're finishing up year A. Our new year starts with Advent in December. And so we turn our attention here to Mark 10, verses 17 through 31. And as we prepare to hear this word this morning that we believe speaks so uniquely to each of our lives through the power of God's Holy Spirit, we thank you, loving God, for this truth, for this word that does have the power to transform us, to guide us, to heal us, to teach us obedience to you out of love, not out of fear, and to be so very grateful that we have been created and placed in this time and place with all of the extraordinary blessings that we have, and even the challenges and the struggles that we have. We thank you. All of it shapes us into the people that you have always known that we could become in Christ Jesus. And so we thank you that somehow in the tension of life, you hold it all. And through the power of your Spirit, you shape us and mold us and meld us into your people. May we as your people be open to your word this day and accept the grace and the blessings that come to us from this truth. In Christ's name we thank you. Amen and amen. And this is Christ Jesus that the gospel writer is talking about. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. And you know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all of these since my youth." And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come and follow me." And when he had heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. And then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." And they were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" And Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." And Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." And Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Sometimes this is an awfully uncomfortable scripture for us to hear, because I think most of us probably feel pretty comfortable in life. And is Jesus suggesting that this is not a good thing, that we can't be close to God if we're comfortable in life? And of course, we have to remember, he's not only speaking a particular truth that still speaks to us today, but he's speaking to people, and in many ways, still us today, who tend to trust more in possessions than God. And that's an easy thing to do, to put our security in those things instead of God. And so that's really what Jesus Christ is beginning to get to the heart at with this young man. And it's interesting that in this story that the young man is searching for ownership. He's searching for gain. How can I get this to be mine? How can I inherit this? And of course, inheritance in this time and age was very, very different than it is today. And if a person was the firstborn son, it was almost automatic that they would receive whatever the father left. But everyone else, they might have gotten something if the son was generous, maybe not. And so again, ownership was seen as something that had a lot of security to it if a person could gain it. And I think even really today, a lot of Christians believe or somehow think or maybe have been taught or formed to believe that somehow faith in God, eternal life, is something that we can earn, is something that doesn't just come to us as a gift. But it's interesting that Jesus doesn't even go directly to this question. He starts to talk to the young man about what goodness is and what he seems to think about being entitled, about being rewarded. And again, I think under our modern day, postmodern day Christianity, we still kind of have this idea that somehow there's rewards, that somehow we're entitled to something from God, especially when we're good people. Good, I put in quotation marks, Jesus is saying only our Father in heaven is good, right? Why we feel we should be rewarded and entitled and, you know, get something when we're following the commandments of God, when we're meeting what we believe ethically and morally we should be doing according to what we read in the scripture. And why sometimes we think it makes us better than the people who don't do these things. Why we should expect rewards and acolytes for the work that we do for God. And it's interesting that William Barclay, in his daily Bible study series, essentially writes, we shouldn't expect anything. Those are things we should be doing anyway, as being disciples, as being people who follow Christ. And to find actually that when we are so transformed by that power of Christ in us, it's no longer us doing it, it's Christ Jesus within us doing it. That's why we can start to love our enemies and start to see the face of Christ in people and forgive them even when they have desperately hurt us, because it is Him inside of us doing that. That's our great reward, friends. That's the gift. And we only need to be open to that and allow that space to take hold. And I hope we don't miss that when this young man comes to Christ Jesus, that Jesus doesn't berate him. He doesn't shame him. He doesn't point out his lack of understanding and wisdom, his selfishness. He looks at him and he loves him. He looks at him and he loves him. And then he says to him, if you want to really know what this is all about, you have to learn how to love the things that God loves. He doesn't essentially say that, but that's what the message is. To learn how to love what God loves. And what does he put out there first and foremost? Those who are poor. Poor in spirit. Poor emotionally, poor economically, poor physically. And we need to also remember that the Jews of this time and many people of this time believed that people who were poor suffered because of their sin or the sin of their parents or their ancestors, and they were seen as unclean people. They were the people on the fringes. They were the shepherds and they were the prostitutes and the tax collectors. Well, tax collectors really weren't poor economically, but they were certainly poor spiritually and most likely emotionally to be able to cheat people the way that they did. But he's really talking about, look, if you have this gift of me in the kingdom of God within you, then this is what you're supposed to do with it. You're supposed to surrender what you believe is yours, what you believe you're entitled to, what I have given to you, and extend that just as readily to the next person. Sometimes that will happen through possession, especially, I think, if the possession is a stumbling block for us. And I have to admit, too, as I've gotten older, I find it easier and easier and easier to give away the things that I never thought I would ever part with. It's the strangest thing coming to that conclusion and taking such delight in seeing other people's reaction, like, oh, thanks. And usually it's my son or my daughters or daughter-in-law, and they're, you know, so really enjoy that. Good, 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 good. But I have to tell you, it's this scripture speaks so loudly to the antithetical things that we can often see clergy do on television. And although Daniel and I don't watch the box itself, we do watch things online. Recently we saw, and I'm reticent to do this, but I will. It was Kenneth Copeland, who is a TV evangelist. Some of you may even watch him. He's very charismatic. But he was walking through the congregation and he was showing off this Breitling watch. Has anybody else seen this? I know Daniel has. And he was saying to the congregation, I have 37 of these, 37 of these, and I have a Bentley with a Breitling clock in it. I thought to myself, whoa. I guess he hasn't come across Mark 10 yet. I'm hoping. Give him the benefit of the doubt. Because if there's one thing we shouldn't be as clergy, is walking through our congregation and somehow shaming them that they don't have what we have because somehow we've been so blessed by God to have what we have and you aren't quite there yet. Imagine what that does to people's heads, thinking about God. But it was pretty close to how some of our ancestors would have thought. I'm loved more, I'm blessed more, I've got more because God loves me more. When Jesus is pretty clear here that the heart of God is close to the poor. In fact, the entire scripture speaks that language, that God's heart is close to the heart of the poor. And I'll tell you what makes me proud for the congregation here at First Presbyterian Church. I am very proud for this congregation. And I have to tell you, and I do tell people this, especially in the community, it's one of the best congregations I've ever served. Because in the leadership meetings, in the session, in the board of deacons, we talk about how we can use our building and our resources, not just for ourselves on Sunday morning, but rather using it for whomever comes to the door and asks in some ethical means. We haven't done anything unethical, don't get me wrong. But we've kept our doors open to outside groups. And here's the other thing, my brothers and sisters. I drive around the town a lot, especially after church on Sunday, and I can't tell you how many churches that I know had church where the parking lot's empty and or it's bound off by some way. There's always a chain, you know, or some kind of rope or something. It says, do not enter or whatever. Do you know we use our building here every day, but every other Saturday, unless there's an outside group, and Friday, unless there's an outside group. That means that this building is used every day for some ministry or some group or somewhere in the community where people have asked to have a space. And I thank my leadership who have often waived the fee to use the building. And I have to tell you, our fees are so low to use the building. And then they put it all toward mission and ministry. They don't put that back into the general budget. That's extraordinary for a mainline church and for this area. And it speaks volumes to the community where people will say to me, every time I go past your church, there's cars in the parking lot. Like, that's so weird. I don't see cars in the parking lot in a church. We have our brothers and sisters at St. Mary's, our Holy Spirit Parish, that, you know, we don't close off our parking lot to them. They can use it. The folks from McGonigal, if they have funerals, and they in turn allow us to use their parking lot without question, although most of the time we do ask. Our brothers and sisters over here at the storage place, we share that space too as well, and they know we're here from that for them as well. And I have to tell you, that's extraordinary. I've served a lot of churches where people didn't feel comfortable with strangers using their stuff, because it can make us so uneasy. What are they gonna do with it? What are they gonna, and what if they ruin it? What if they take it? I don't know about that. But this congregation really is different in that way. And I know, and my boards have talked about this, and they're beginning to pray about it and to discern what more we can be doing with our space and with our resources, guided by God. They're praying about that, to discern where God might call us next in terms of building use and more, especially since the course of the last 2.5 years, we spent so much time repairing the building. We have a few more things to do, but they're talking about now, what else, what next, what else, what next. And here's the other thing. Remember that a congregation size never limits what God can do, ever. It's us who do that when we shut the door. The congregational size never limits what God can do, and that never comes up in any of our discussions when we're discerning what God can do here. Recently, I read that a group of small Presbyterian churches in the Eastern North Carolina, New Hope Presbytery, you know what they did? These are little rural churches, and our member, Octavia Payne, grew up in one of those churches. They went together and they pulled their resources and they spent over $3 million wiping out the medical debt that was in their region. Imagine that. Little tiny country churches pulling together and wiping out $3 million worth of medical debt because they recognized they couldn't do it on their own. But if they partnered with their brothers and sisters, that there's a lot that God could do. And that's what they did. Our good friend, the Reverend Dr. Harold Hutchison, which I know some of you met, I'm gonna say hi, Harold, because even though he's down in North Carolina, he told me, I get on every week and I worship with you down there. And he goes to Caldwell Presbyterian Church, and I know many of you know that congregation. I talked about it when I first got here, I think my first Sunday when I was here. Caldwell Presbyterian at one time had about 12 members, and they had voted to close the church. And then this couple came in the following Sunday. They voted to close the church on a Saturday night, and Sunday morning when they announced it, this interracial couple had been there at worship, and the young man thought to himself, now I'm black, my white wife is beside me, and not one person looked sideways at us. We can't let this happen. They made a film about this. It's wonderful. If you want to see it, Google Caldwell Presbyterian Church. And the next Sunday, they brought about 50 people with them. And the next Sunday after that, they had about 50 more. That church is now thriving. That's where Harold goes. Of course, when we're Presbyterian pastors, we can't join that church, but we can worship in one. And he said, they are now just thriving, and they have prayerfully discerned that they're going to refurbish part of their building and turn it into apartments for homeless people, because the homeless problem is so dramatic there in Charlotte, North Carolina. And this was a church within the last 10 years that thought they would close, that had voted to close. And one older gentleman in that church, in the film, if you watch the film, who had been there since the 1930s, said there was more love in that church than he had experienced in all of his life. And that's the key. Love. And not just a sentimental kind of warm, fuzzy feeling, but the love that comes from God, that teaches us the justice of God, the righteousness of God, the holiness of God, goodness of God, the peace of God, the forgiveness and the compassion of God, where we look at those who live on the fringes and we don't right away judge them and think, well, but rather our heart is moved like the heart of Christ Jesus to ask, what is it that you need? What is it that you want? And if we want to know how to live in that state of eternal life that this young man is asking Christ Jesus for, understand that he's talking about being born again, and being born again happens through the Holy Spirit, and we are taken to this place where God resides in us, and we begin to see it in the world. And you know how that happens, besides asking for it and praying for it, but that journey that happens is what Paul talks about in Romans 12:2. The place where God is, the place where God calls us to, not conform to the pattern of the world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Through relationship with God, the Holy Spirit, the Father, the Son, each other, and with those who see life from a different perspective than we do. We must really have our minds renewed and transformed in such a way that we can see this, my brothers and sisters, where God lives and how God is determining who is going to be first and who is last, not us. God is determining this, not us. Because in many ways, privilege, which is wonderful, wonderful, and I'm grateful for it, it also limits our perspective in many ways. While we didn't choose to have, while others have not, we know, God knows this. But in this perspective of having, if we're not actively working toward an equity and some kind of participation that's not just passive, that enables systems of inequity and injustice, we have to ask ourselves how Christ Jesus can and will continually invite us to see differently if we don't allow ourselves to encounter and engage with those who we know are on the bottom of our economic and educational and societal world. And you might be thinking, oh, it's just such a nice picture, Pastor Lori. It's so easy to say there from that pulpit. And it's probably easy to hear when we're in this beautiful space. And what a blessing that is. But as Christ Jesus reassures his disciples, so does the scripture reassure us that we don't lose out when God does the impossible within us. And Jesus goes on to talk about the material things that come to us, but honestly, it echoes 1 Corinthians 2:9, that eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has entered in the heart of humanity the things which God has prepared for those who love. And we need to remember that. We never lose when we follow God, but we constantly gain everything, especially life. And I leave you with this, my brothers and sisters. Jesus looks at us with such love as he did the rich young ruler. And when we see that gaze of love, how can we not turn then in the same way with such eyes of Christ in us to each other and understand what a reward this is, what a gift this is? Because the truth is, we take nothing into the next life with us, only what we have done. Nothing we own and nothing we think that is ours, we take none of that with us. We are always called to surrender it. And if we surrender it early, now think about this, if we learn how to surrender it early, with God's direction to relieve the suffering of those whom God in turn looks at in love too, that's that good old treasure that's getting piled up somewhere far away, as many people believe, on roads paved in gold, and that place to the other side. That's the reward, that we get to even participate in the work of God. And you know what that makes us? That makes us co-creators. And we get to create the environment in which we think and move and live. That's the gift. If we understand that the kingdom where God is, where that life eternal is about union, it's about union, and it's about communion, which means it's also about mercy, and it's about forgiveness, and it's about nonviolence and surrender and solidarity and service and patience and a life of simplicity. Who can doubt that this is the sum and the substance of the teaching of Christ Jesus? In the reign of God, the very motive for rivalry and greed and violence gets destroyed. And friends, this is when and where we can know that we're all part of God's beloved community. When we learn to put aside what keeps us from dwelling in such places as this. It's the central axiom, which means a central teaching of Christ Jesus, that the last really do have a head start in moving toward first. And those who spend too much time trying to be first will never get there. And so in essence, Jesus is looking at that young man and looking at us with such love and basically saying, stop trying and just be open. And guess what? I promised to come in to your life and to change it. And not just your life, but everyone else around you, if you keep that door open and understand that this is what it means to live with eternal life where God is. Amen and amen. And my brothers and sisters, as we continue to ponder the ways in which the Lord may have spoken to each of us today, I invite you to sit back and listen to this special music, The Eye of the Needle. Somehow that sounds a little, borrowed.
It is to some degree. At first, I want to thank Tyrone again for being up here.
Yeah, he is.
Song work. You can't see him over there. He is in the drum booth. And you'll hear him, though. You definitely will hear him. And thank you, Tyrone, once again for doing this. It's yes, as your creative music director, my mind sort of wandered. I read this gospel, and the first thing that hit me was this song. So I sort of extracted what I thought would be lyrics, and I think Elise might put them up on the screen, but we did print some out, and they're floating around in the pews for you. So I did change the lyrics slightly, but you may recognize the song once you hear it, because there is no song called Eye of the Needle, but Tyrone's going to kick it off, and you'll hear the song. Right, Tyrone?
Yeah. Let's do it.
I have a story to tell you. You want to know just what you should do to gain eternal life. It's quite simple, it's hard to accept. Your possessions won't matter. You take the money and share with the poor. You wanna see the light? It's the eye of the needle that the camel goes through. Jesus said, impossible as it may seem. It's the earth for this to happen, that a man who is rich to get into heaven has to the eye of a needle. Thank you.
great.
I took a bow.
That was wonderful.
That's great. I want to thank you for doing that, because this is, it really adds to it. The song wouldn't have been the same without Tyrone back there at the drum booth, really, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that's great. Come on up, Miss Annie. There he is. Please join with me in prayer. Well, loving God, we thank you. We praise you for the gifts, the talents, the energy, the ideas, all of the things that come through this congregation, but especially the stewardship and the foundation that we've been given in our legacy. And in so many ways, you continue to bless this congregation, and we ask your blessing upon these gifts that we dedicate to you this morning, that they will be used and guided by people filled with your sense of intelligence, compassion, wisdom, and peace, so that the gifts will always be used for the relief of need, the good of people, the good of the church, and the good of the world. And we thank you again for the extraordinary blessings that we've been given here. We dedicate them to you. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you. Well, my brothers and sisters, as we offer our prayers this morning, I ask you also to keep in your prayer the things that are written on the back of the bulletin, the prayer concerns. Please keep Selby's in prayer. Bill called this morning, and Esther has fallen, and she broke her hip, so they're taking her to Mercy Hospital. Miss Annie here, Pastor Annie, will be covering... Pastor will call for me while I'm away, so I thank her for that. And I ask you to pray for Daniel and I. We'll be leaving on retreat a little later today. We'll be staying in a retreat center in Ohio and resting, reading, praying that week. And I ask for your prayers. I'll covet your prayers while I'm gone. And pray for the congregation as well. And Leslie Stone, who will fill the pulpit for me one last time next Sunday. And we thank you, loving God, for this day. We thank you for the rain that we have so needed. Sometimes we don't like that inconvenience, but it's just so wonderful to see gardens still and flowers and the earth watered, and we are so grateful for it. Thank you. But thank you also for the things that make our life so easy. Thank you for our health and our well-being. Thank you that we exist. Thank you for the many people that you bring into our lives who are blessings to us, who support us in so many ways, who love us and help to create the people that we are. And we thank you for congregations, not only here at First Presbyterian, but all over the world that exists because you have established them and you are guiding them and giving them ministry and mission. You bless so many congregations with people who have ideas and creativity and an openness to you, who understand that now they are different and changed. How can they be of service to you and to others? May we always seek your wisdom in these things, always desire to be guided by you, your goodness, your sense of mercy, justice, and peace. And we thank you that we know your heart is close to those who are stricken by systems of poverty, abuse, homelessness, and abuse. Send your angels to be close to them as your angels are sent to us. May we begin to see our brothers and sisters as you see us, loved, redeemed, valuable, savable. May we see the face of Christ in one another and be less likely to jump to judgment or criticism, and more likely to be as you are in the gospel today, listening and looking with love and answering in the wisdom of the Spirit. Not to shame or persecute, but rather to build up, knowing that as we build one another up, we build up the body of Christ, and we too are included in that building. It's a benefit to others, it's a benefit to us. May we recognize those are the treasures that are being saved and protected for us in heaven, whatever those treasures may be. And maybe it'll simply be you taking our hand and looking at us with such love. And what a treasure that will be. As we lift our deepest joys and concerns to you, we include those that were named at the beginning of this time of prayer, and also our families who are traveling this weekend to see their sons and daughters who are at school, at college, for our brothers and sisters who are homesick with the bug that's traveling around, and our brothers and sisters who are at a distance who worship with us, our brothers and sisters who are in places where there is war and oppression and continual hunger and thirst in so many levels, for our brothers and sisters who are cleaning up after hurricanes and storms, wildfires and mudslides and floods. It's so easy to become hopeless when we see our life's work wash away before us, and we may wonder, where do we put our hope? May we turn our eyes skyward, heavenward, and believe our help comes from our Redeemer on high, over us, more knowledgeable than us, more capable and wise, and absolutely more loving. And in that love, loving God, we reside. We lift to you all of our joys, our deepest concerns. We trust the fact you take them into yourself, and through the power of your Holy Spirit, we can believe that life truly is transformed, so that we might rest assured that in the end, in Christ Jesus, that all shall be made well. All shall be made well. All manner of life shall surely be made well. And we believe you hear us now in the prayer that Christ Jesus has given to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, as we close our service today, I invite you to stand and join together in our closing song of peace, How Great is Our God, verse 2. Brothers and sisters, remember you have the eternal life of God within you. Jesus Christ is within you. The good news is within you. You're called to take this out into the world and to never be afraid. For it is Jesus Christ who strides out before you. He goes ahead of you. He prepares a place for you. He waits there for you. And when you lose your way, my brothers and sisters, I guarantee you, he will turn back on that road to meet you. And I bless you now in the power of our living, loving Creator God, our Abba Father, who loves you more than you could ever imagine, whose love sent Jesus Christ into this world to teach us and show us and reveal to us the life, the truth, and the way. And the Holy Spirit that has the power to bind you to God and to one another. Hallelujah and amen. Have a wonderful week, my brothers and sisters.
Did you see?